feel discouraged. Don't have to wonder where he'll be. God's been in time, on time, every time. For me, for me, for me.
Yes, my God was in time.
In time for the children of Israel across the mighty Red Sea.
He was on time.
On time when the walls of Jericho fell. And Joshua must be every time. I feel discouraged.
Peace Haven. Let's all stand together if you can, if you're able. Ain't it good to be in the house of the Lord tonight? Let's go to Him in a word of prayer. Father, we love you, God. We thank you. We praise you, God, just for this ability that you've given us to come out to your house tonight. God, we want to sing your praises. We want to lift you up. Father, we want to make much of Jesus so that all men would be drawn to him, Lord. I pray that you will just bless our songs. Lord, may we worship you freely, God. Pray that you will bless Pastor John and his message tonight, and that you'll just use us mightily, God. We love you, and we thank you, God. For it's in Jesus' name we pray, amen. Who's ready to sing something? One person out of 5,000. That's really sad. Let's try it again. Who wants to sing something tonight? Okay, well, let's sing something then, okay?
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away.
Father, we look forward to that day, Lord, when you call your children home by the undertaker or the undertaker, God, it doesn't matter because it's all going to be good for a child of God. Father, I pray that you would just once again bless in this service, Father. Pray would you use the church, Father, touch Pastor John. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated.
Everybody, as you can see, or as I'm sure you've already been able to tell, Rebecca and I are out of town this evening. We'll be out of town for a few days. We'll be back on Saturday. But I did want to continue this Revelation series, and so I wanted to make sure that we had some continuity here. And so I hope you don't mind tonight, but I will be speaking, of course, from the screen. If you will, go ahead and turn in your Bibles to Revelation chapter 9. Revelation chapter 9. Tonight we're going to be looking at this title, All Hell Breaks Loose. As I mentioned last week, many times we use that phraseology, and we use it kind of, I guess, lightly in certain senses, but what we're looking at here is we're looking at something that is quite literal. And we saw that last week, and we'll review some of that, you know, as we move forward. Before we get started, I do want you to go back in quick review and look at chapter 8 and look at verse 13. And we'll be in chapter 9 tonight, but look at chapter 8, look at verse 13. John says this, "And I looked and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice," here it is, "woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth because of the remaining blast of the trumpet of the three angels who are about to sound." Now, when we see this in chapter 8, what we understand is these three woes are actually declared, and we know them to be the fifth, the sixth, and the seventh trumpet judgment. Last week, we looked at the fifth trumpet judgment, where Satan was given the key to release many incarcerated demons from the abyss or the pit and scatter them all over the earth. And if you remember, these demons took on the form of locusts, and they stung people for five solid months. And these people are in so much pain that they try to kill themselves, but our Bible tells us, even though they try to kill themselves, with every effort, they cannot die. Death will not come. We made the correlation last week between that and hell itself. Hell itself is a place where the body is on fire, or the soul is on fire, but death is impossible. Getting back here, according to verse 12, the fifth trumpet is the very first woe. Remember back in chapter 8, verse 13, there are three woes. Those woes are the fifth, the sixth, and the seventh trumpet. And so when we get to verse 12 here in Revelation 9, the Bible tells us the fifth trumpet is the first woe, and then there are two more to come. So tonight what we're going to look at is we're going to look at the sixth trumpet, which of course is the second woe. First of all, if you will, notice the thunderings. In verse 13 of chapter 9, the thunderings. "Then the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar, which is before God." The Bible says that a voice comes from before the throne of God, and it was heard. Now, if you go back again to chapter 8, just real quickly. I won't have you do this all night. But chapter 8, if you will, look at verse number 5, because as we understand, the Bible is the best commentary on the Bible. As we see this, look at verse number 5. The Bible says in chapter 8, "Then the angel took the censer, filled it with fire from the altar, and threw it to the earth." And here it is. "And there were noises, thunderings, lightnings." And the Bible says there's an earthquake. In other words, the voice sounds like thunder. I'm not going to have you turn back there, but if you remember way back when we started, and John told us in chapter 1 of Revelation that the voice of Jesus Christ is like the sound of many waters, and we kind of compared that to Niagara Falls. But throughout the Bible, God's voice is described as being thunderous. Let me give you this from Job chapter 37 and verse number 4. Job 37 verse number 4, our Bible tells us, "After it a voice roars, he," being God, "thunders with his majestic voice, and he does not restrain them when his voice is heard. Also, Job tells us in Job 37 and verse 5, God thunders marvelously with his voice. He does great things which we cannot comprehend. And we could go on and on, but for sure, when God speaks, even E.F. Hutton has to be quiet and listen. In this particular case, God is demanding that the prayers of the souls under the altar from chapter 6 be answered. And it's time for the earth to be judged and for God's name to be vindicated. And this comes with a thunderous voice. Notice secondly, the thousands. Look at verse 14. Saying to the sixth angel who had the trumpet, release the four angels who are bound at the great river Euphrates. So the four angels who had been prepared for the hour and day and month and year were released, and here it is, to kill a third of mankind. Now the number of the army of the horsemen was 200 million. I heard the number of them. This sixth angel is commanded by God to loose the four angels, or the four demons, which are apparently bound by the river Euphrates. Now just for clarification, do not confuse these four demons with the four angels of chapter 7. The four angels of chapter 7 are good angels, and they are the angels that are restraining evil on earth. But what is happening now is things are beginning to intensify through this fifth and sixth and seventh trumpet judgment. As we look at the sixth trumpet judgment, our Bible tells us that this sixth angel is commanded by God to loose four angels, and again, four demons, which are bound by the river Euphrates. Now, just for some historical significance, the river Euphrates flows through what used to be called Babylon. Currently today, it is actually flowing through the country of Iraq. But a lot of biblical activity was surrounded by that river. It's like 1,780 miles long, and it flows from the original location of Eden. Now, just to give you some things about this. Number one, the first sin took place by the river. Adam and Eve committed their first sin by the river. Secondly, the first murder took place around the river. Cain and Abel, you know, that whole incident took place there. And then the diversity of tongues took place around the river at the Tower of Babel. So the river Euphrates has a lot of historical significance. Number one, the first sin was committed there. Number two, Cain and Abel, the first murder was committed there. Number three, the Tower of Babel, the diversity of tongues, it took place there. So the river will once again play a huge significant role in the prophecy, and that according to Revelation chapter 16, verse number 12, the Bible says, then the sixth angel poured out his bowl of the great river Euphrates, and its water was dried up, so that the way of the kings from the east might be prepared. So what we see here is this river will once again play a huge significant role in the prophecy, and that the reason that it is significant is because the Euphrates River more or less actually divides the Orient from the Middle East. In order for this to happen from Revelation chapter 16 verse 12, in order for the army to march from the Orient all the way to the Middle East, the Euphrates River must be taken out of the equation. Here in Revelation chapter 9, verse 16, what we read is these four demons that are released, they're going to prepare an army. If you've got an old King James, it's going to read 200,000,000. If you've got a new King James or another translation, it's probably going to read 200 million. And you ask yourself, where is this army going to come from? Well, we just read it in Revelation chapter 16, verse number 12. Our Bible is very clear. It is coming from the Far East, China most likely. But they will march right across the canyon that used to be flowing with water that we know now to be the Euphrates River. So notice thirdly, number one, the thunderings. Number two, the thousands. Notice thirdly, the third. Go back and read verse 15 again, and then we're going to skip down to verse 17. So the four angels, the four demons who had been prepared for the hour and day and month and year were released to kill a third of mankind. Skip down to verse 17. Thus I saw the horses in the vision. Those who sat on them had breastplates of fiery red, hyacinth blue, and sulfur yellow. And the heads of horses were like this head of lions. And out of their mouths came fire and smoke and brimstone. Verse 18. By these three plagues, a third of mankind was killed. By the fire and the smoke and the brimstone which came out of their mouths. For their power is in their mouth and in their tails. For their tails are like serpents having heads. And with them they do harm. So in chapter 6, we saw this. We saw one-fourth of mankind, a fourth part, was killed. Now we get to chapter 9, and we read that a third of mankind is going to be killed. That means at this point, when you add the one-fourth killed in chapter 6, and then you add the one-third killed in chapter 9, somewhere around half the Earth's population is going to be dead. If that was to happen today, well over 3 billion people, 3.6 billion people would be dead. They won't be able to bury these people fast enough. Now, one of the fascinating things that I find here in chapter 9 is the description that John gives in verse 17. Go back and read verse 17 with me again. Now remember, John is writing this some 2,000 years ago. But pay close attention to his descriptive terms. And thus I saw the horses in the vision. Those who sat on them had breastplates of fiery red, hyacinth blue, and sulfur yellow. And the heads of the horses were like the heads of lions. And out of their mouths came fire, smoke, and brimstone. Now, you know, just in looking at that, one thing we have to remember is that John has never seen a tank. John has never seen a helicopter. John has never seen an element of modern warfare. All of the stuff that we take for granted today, to John, that is foreign to him. Now today we see huge, gigantic implements of warfare that John could not have readily comprehended. But in reality, I would dare say that John was describing here nuclear warfare. And he was seeing possibly implements of warfare that maybe we've never seen, maybe like a helicopter, maybe like something similar to that, firing from the front, the Bible says, and firing from the back. What else other than nuclear warfare could account for the decimation of one-third of the Earth's population? A destruction of this magnitude is well within the reach of a nuclear holocaust, as we know. So number one, in this passage, we see the thunderings. Number two, we see the thousands. Number three, we see the third that is destroyed. Number four, notice this, the thoughtlessness. Look at verse 20. But the rest of mankind, who were not killed by these plagues, did not repent of the works of their hands, that they should not worship demons and idols of gold, silver, brass, stone, and wood, which can neither see nor hear nor walk. And they did not repent of their murders or their sorceries or their sexual immorality or their thefts. Webster's Dictionary defines thoughtless, and this is going to be my point here. Webster's Dictionary defines thoughtless as this: it's said or done without having given thought to a probable result. Now pay attention to that. Thoughtless. It's said or done without having given any thought to the probable result. Now, what could be more thoughtless than to refuse to repent after you see well over 3 billion people all around you killed? And yet, that's exactly what the Bible says here. The Bible says the rest of mankind who were not killed by these plagues, the amazing thing is it says they did not repent. According to John, they go right on as though nothing has happened. They are completely thoughtless in their actions. First of all, what we see is they continue in their diabolical religion. Go back and look at verse 20. But the rest of mankind who were not killed by these plagues, they did not repent of the works of their hands. Watch what they do. That they should not worship demons and idols of gold, silver, brass, stone, and wood, which can neither see nor hear nor walk. Instead of recognizing the living God as the only one to worship, they deify the very demons that are out there to destroy them. And they continue to worship empty idols of gold, silver, brass, stone, and wood. They can't speak. They can't hear. They can't walk. They can't talk. John says that they can't do any of these things. But in spite of the fact that God has proven himself to be the living God and the only one that is worth worshiping, and the great I am, instead of worshiping the great I am, they're worshiping the Arnots. They're made of stone, they're made of wood, they're inanimate. They can't do one thing for anybody, and yet they continue to worship in spite of everything that they have seen. Notice, secondly, they continue not only in a diabolical religion, but they also continue in diametric rebellion. Verse 21 tells us, and they did not repent of their murders, or their sorceries, or their sexual morality, or their thefts. And everything that God has said no to, during this period of time, they are saying yes. You know, four of these rebellions are mentioned specifically. Number one, you see there in verse 21, murders. Murders. Now think about this. I personally am of the belief that at this point, the church is going to be taken out. I believe at this point that the church has already been raptured at before the beginning of the tribulation, and I do believe that the church is out of here. Now you think about this. Right now, what part does the church play? The church represents Christ. We are the light. We are the salt. We are the ones that are promoting righteousness. And we may not be doing a great job at it, but we're at least here trying to do that through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now I want you to think about this. As soon as the church is taken out, the representation of righteousness to a large degree has been removed from this earth. Now you think about it. You know, I was just reading this past week of all the murders that have taken place in Chicago. And every week when you read about it, and I'm just not throwing off on Chicago, but it's just specifically, it seems Chicago every week just has murder after murder after murder after murder. You think about how horrible that is. And then you take the church out of the equation and think about how horrible it's going to get. As bad as things are now, think about a time in the tribulation when the church is non-existent in its influence. During the tribulation, violent murders, I believe, are going to run rampant. Not only that, there'll be sorceries. Sorceries in verse 21. The Bible talks about sorceries. In the Bible, sorceries are commonly interrelated with occultic drug and alcohol abuse. As you look throughout Scripture, you know, Galatians chapter 5, verse 20 refers to it as witchcraft. These sorceries and this witchcraft always led to demonic activity. That's what's going to be going on. Even today, what are the results of drug and alcohol abuse? Almost always, they lead to further dissensions into the deepest depths of sin. And drug addiction is no longer, you know, as you think about, you know, as I was growing up, when you think about somebody that was on drugs, somebody that was a drug addict, it was kind of exclusive to the down and outers. But, you know, as we've progressed in society, what we have seen is we've seen a lot of people, a lot of white-collar people who are addicted to cocaine and even now to prescription drugs and alcohol. They begin to use drugs to help handle the stress, but in the end, they find themselves associated with a group or a lifestyle that takes them further than they want to go, and as we've said, keeps them longer than they want to stay, and costs them much more than they want to pay. When a person involves themselves in substance abuse, they are opening doorways to the mind that God wants to keep shut. Substance abuse is like saying, hey, demons, here, come on, take control of my mind. And for sure, you cannot be sober. And you cannot be vigilant. Remember what the Bible says in 1 Peter 5:8. I don't have it for you, but you can probably quote it yourself. Be sober, be vigilant, for your adversary the devil, as a roaring lion, he's walking about seeking whom he may devour. Now think about how difficult, if not impossible, that it is to be sober and vigilant when the demons of this world are controlling your mind because of the drug and alcohol abuse that is running rampant. You can't bring every thought into captivity when your thoughts are overshadowed by drugs. You cannot. There's only one way to stay in perfect peace in your heart and in your mind, and that's to keep your thoughts on God. Isaiah 26:3 is one of the verses that I send to people, you know, when they're going through a very hard time. It may be that, you know, they're in a time of turmoil or bereavement. I got a friend of mine right now that many of you know. He doesn't go to church here, but he has sang several times here, and he's one of our favorite singers that we bring in. But his son just passed away last week, and I know that he is hurting. I know his wife is hurting. I know that family and that community is hurting over a 28-year-old son who has died well before his time, as we would say. But one verse that I sent to him was Isaiah 26:3, and it's this: you will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Think about that. You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. That's a verse worth memorizing, Isaiah 26:3. You cannot keep your mind on God unless your mind is free from substance abuse. And these people refuse to repent of their sorceries. Notice also fornication. Don't have to say a whole lot here because we know this subject all too well. Fornication, it comes from the Greek word porneo, and it describes immorality, an immorality that is going to run rampant. It's going to be, a free-for-all for everybody in this particular sense. And then there is theft. Verse 21, theft, a total disregard for human rights, a total disregard for private property. You know, several years ago, you know, I can't remember exactly which hurricane it was that I was watching, but this would be true probably for every hurricane in modern times. But I remember I was watching, and it was so shameful when officers had to be posted 24/7 to keep thieves from stealing what little bit hurricane victims had left. It's just a sad thing. It's also a sad thing, even right now as we think about this. You know, I get these phone calls all the time. They're scam calls. And it's people out there trying to take advantage of people maybe who are elderly and maybe who aren't thinking exactly right on that particular day, or maybe, you know, to some degree have lost some of their mental capacity. And there are these people that get on the phone and they want your social security number, and they want your IDs, and they want your name, and they your phone number. They're trying to get all the information that they can for one reason, so they can steal from you. And this is already running rampant. I mean, I get 4 or 5 phone calls a day from these people. Now you think about this, during this particular time, think about the thievery that's going to be going on. At the sixth trumpet, forget the hurricanes, people will walk into a house, and I'm just going to be frank, they're going to walk into a house, rape the women, steal the TV, kill the man, and trade the TV for drugs. That's exactly what's being described here. Walk into your house, of course, hopefully you won't be here, hopefully you are a born-again believer and you won't have to go through this, but people are going to walk into people's houses, rape women, steal TVs, steal their stuff, kill the man, trade the TV or trade the stuff for drugs. And they won't bat an eye while they're doing it. They will not even care. It's not going to bother them whatsoever. They are completely thoughtless and they are completely unrepentant. It just goes to prove that punishment alone does not change a person's heart. You say, what changes a person's heart? The changing of a man's heart comes exclusively from the one who died for us, the one who can redeem us, the one who can regenerate us. This is God Himself, and it happens at the moment that you trust Him. The gospel is still the answer today. And by the way, the gospel will be available to a large degree during this time. Remember, there's going to be 144,000 witnesses that are going to be preaching. Jewish witnesses, 12,000 from each tribe. Now, a lot of the Jewish people, they will leave Judea. They will go to the mountains, possibly Petra. They will be kept there by God and protected and provided for there by God. But then you have 144,000 witnesses. This is just a beautiful picture of God's mercy, that in the midst of all of this mess, that God still loves people and God still wants to save people. God doesn't have to have a witness during this time. God doesn't have to demonstrate mercy and grace during this time. God doesn't have to have gospel availability at this time. But the heart of God is that He loves everybody, for God so loved the world. And that's not just limited to a certain time. That's limited to all of Earth's time. And it's not limited to just certain people. It extends to every person. And so what we need to understand is this, even during this time when all of this mess is going on, and all this turmoil and pandemonium is occurring, God Himself still has witnesses. He still has that 144,000. And they are proclaiming the gospel. And certain people, as we have read, will be saved. So during our time, the gospel is the answer. During this time, the gospel is going to be the answer. Because there is only one person that can change a man's heart or change a woman's heart. And that is Jesus Himself. Which brings us to this final thought. This final thought. We've looked at all these verses and we've looked at this particular trumpet judgment. And we come to this. After seeing the fifth and sixth woe of chapter 9, here's where we are now. We're about to go into the seventh woe, you know, as we move forward. However, here's what we see. What we are seeing is we are seeing the horror of the world in contrast to what we can be thankful for. I can speak on my own behalf, and I probably many of you tonight, as you think about this, as you think about the thunderings, God's voice of judgment, as you think about the thousands who are going to come against each other, as you think about the third of mankind that is going to be killed, as you think about the thoughtlessness of certain people because they do not repent. In all of this, would you take a moment and would you just relish in thankfulness? The thankfulness just simply being this, that God has saved you, that God has given you clearly His gospel, that He has drawn you to Himself, and that this will not involve you. Now, I may be talking to somebody today and you say, Pastor John, if I died right now, I don't know that I would go to heaven. Or if the Lord came back and took his church, I don't know that I would be going with the church. I don't know that Christ would be rapturing me and taking me to heaven. I want to say this to you. As we've already said, I just want to reiterate and reiterate it very clearly. Jesus died for you. He was buried. He rose again. And in all of that, what he was doing is he was conquering the power of sin that drags you to hell and conquering physical death and the second death so that you would not have to die and go to hell. And so tonight, I beg, I plead, I implore you, if you can't be thankful right now for the salvation that has delivered you from all of this, take a moment, ask the Lord to speak to you. His Holy Spirit may be drawing you right now, and put your faith and your trust alone in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. For the rest of us tonight, just want to say this, it sure is great to know that Jesus has made his gospel so available to us, and he wants us to share it, so let's continue to do so. God bless you tonight. Hope you have a great week. Hope to see you Sunday morning at 10:30. Let's pray. Lord, I'm so grateful to be part of this church. God, I'm grateful for faithful people, Lord, who want to study your word and they want to learn and grow. God, help us to know that this book and this study doesn't do us any good unless, first of all, we've accepted you as our Savior, and secondly, that we're sharing the gospel with others. Lord, as the song says, to know God and to make God known. So thank you for the book of Revelation where we can know you, and thank you that we can make these truths known. We love you tonight. We ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
If you would stand, let's sing the song. See, we fall down.
We fall down. We lay our crowns at the feet.
Collins, would you dismiss us in prayer, brother?